Hi. I passed out from, I did a master's in computer science from Wadia College under the University of Pune way back in 95. If any of you have heard, Dr. Mrs. S.C. Shirvaikar was our head of department and one of the primary teachers there. And I fondly remember my days in college. Like you, we also had, a four-term course. And in the last term, we did our industrial training. Where I was picked up by a company called Jopasna. And then since then, I've worked, I've traveled around the world. I've worked in various companies, large and small, various sizes and various types. I've worked for startups, I've worked for large companies. And all of that industry experience, still always reminds me of the fact that we are so connected to our teachers and our schools, and it gives me a pleasure to talk to students. So I seek such opportunities to talk to students, and I'm grateful to Dr. Jayaraman that he gave me this opportunity today. So I know this center is for simulation and modeling. I do not know how much directly you are related to computing as such, as in software development. I am primarily from software development background. I don't know how many of you will be making your careers in computing or software development, but the world is moving at such a pace, and we have all these connected devices, all these small things with us. They're so pervasive and so all around us that I thought my area of work, which is Internet of Things, I thought I should just do a very high level overview of it with you guys. And let's see, let's have fun, let's keep it interactive. Please raise your hand and ask me, stop me and ask me questions anytime. Don't feel afraid or anything. The more interactive it is, the more fun we will have. I am primarily here to have fun with you guys. I hope you guys do the same, okay? Are we good? Shall I proceed? Okay, these are the things we are going to talk about. So this Internet of Things, right? So what are these things? So let's take a look at some of these things. Thing is a very generic word, and you will have probably even read a lot about. Nowadays, in newspapers also, they are writing about Internet of Things and how it's going to change our lives. So I'm sure you must have, you have some exposure to these things. So let's look at them a little bit detail. In any IoT, so IoT is a big topic, and it is like you have entire courses based on IoT, and I teach some parts of a course in a Symbiosis business school in Hinjawadi near our office. So point is, this is a big topic and we cannot really cover everything, but we'll just touch all the high level things and so that you know what all is part of IoT, how it touches our lives, and if you guys would like to do anything about it or with it in your careers, then you'll get an idea. So we'll talk about the various layers that are there in IoT and various things and components that are part of those layers. We'll take a look at all the different protocols, the new ones, the old ones that are part of IoT, old ones that are reused in IoT, new ones that are specifically built for IoT. We'll look at some key functions of what any IoT system will have so that you recognize the different parts of the large system, and then you perhaps recognize the parts where you can connect with somehow. And application areas are simply too many to cover, so we're just going to look at some of them, and we'll talk about some applications, because I suppose that will be the most interesting part for you to see where all this is applied and how it affects our life. Okay, so let's take a look at things first. I think we have about an hour and a half, or maybe slightly more. Let's see how we do on time. And based on how interactive it is and how many questions we have, let's see how much time we take. So yeah, a thing, a theoretical definition of a thing, yeah, is any connected object today. So your mobile phones are connected objects. Those security cameras outside are connected objects. And these are just a few examples. Essentially, it's a physical object, some kind of physical object, an entity. To participate in the Internet of Things, one of the key things it needs to have is a unique identifier. Because once you when you're getting data from that object, you need to know who is sending that data, right? So it's part of the security. So you need to have a unique, that object needs to have a unique identifier. It is typically an embedded system because it is doing some data collection. If a camera will, you know, catch images, a temperature sensor will sense ambient temperature. So it's collecting some kind of data, and it is sending out somewhere. So you need some kind of a small computing infrastructure built into that device. That's a given. So typically, it's called as an embedded system. And obviously, the ability to transfer data over a network, to connect to a network and to transfer data over a network. Yeah. So now this is a very basic definition. With this, can you come up with some examples? I already gave two. Can you come up with a few more examples? Can you think of some things that will classify as a sensor or as a thing in the IoT?
For smart vehicle.
Smart vehicle. Yes, that's a very complex thing, by the way, but you're right, you're not wrong. Any other simpler things? Home automation systems, yes, but what is a, see, a thing, when you say home automation system, it comprises of a lot of things. So can you give me one or two examples of actual objects within home automation system?
Maybe light sensors.
Okay, yes, light sensors, yes. ACs, yes. Motion sensor, yes. Speakers, anybody? Yeah, okay, fine. So now, so that really covers everything. It doesn't leave anything. Today, if you see all the objects, these monitors are things because you display something on them. This projector is a thing. This mic is a thing. I mean, there are so many things. The speakers are things. So nowadays, it has become all pervasive, really. All the things that we used to use previously are now getting added the capability of some computing, some sensing, and some communication. And they are becoming part of Internet of Things landscape. And you know, the system is everywhere around us, OK? Now I have, you know, put in some quotes by some industry and business people. You will probably recognize most of them. So what do they have to say about the Internet of Things, and why is it important for us? What are the application areas it's going to have, and how is it going to affect our lives? All these things come out from this quotes. So I thought it will be good to have these quotes. Plus, these are you know, people who are eminent businessmen and technologists, and they are running successful businesses based on all these things. So they have well thought out and you know, very useful or very seminal opinion about the Internet of Things. So let's see what they have to say. So this is Eric Schmidt, from who was a formerly, of course, this is an old quote, formerly Google chairman. He says the internet will disappear. Okay, there will be so many IP addresses and devices, sensors, things that you are wearing, things that you are interacting with, that you won't even sense it. So you don't even know that you are participating in an IoT system. Okay, it will be so ubiquitous, if I can use that word. So you walk into a room and the room is dynamic, and it will, with your permission and all that, because that is also important and part of security. You know, speakers will start playing the music that you like the moment you enter that room, and so on. IoT is transforming the everyday physical objects that surround us into an ecosystem of information that will enrich our lives. Refrigerators, parking spaces, houses, of course, houses are big things, but you wouldn't have thought that a refrigerator will take part, a microwave oven will take part in an IoT system, but they will be, according to this quote, and they are. If you, there are already microwave ovens that are enabled with you know, Wi-Fi, and they will connect to the internet, download recipes, and cook whatever you put in them for, based on what timing comes from that recipe and all that. So all that is true today. And because it is touching so many things around us, everything, you know, and all of this involves money, you know, you buy a microwave oven and then you pay money to all the parts that went into the microwave oven, including the IoT parts. So essentially, this is about business and big business. So that's why, you know, he says it's likely to make IoT a multi-trillion dollar industry in the near future. This is from a PricewaterhouseCoopers report. Yeah, I think mobile devices, I need not read this out. Mobile devices are so critical and crucial, and they are like, they are even powerful devices, more powerful than your computers that we use for our work, and they are in our pockets with such small form factor. You may not, your lab may not have all computers connected to the internet, or they will have some firewall, this, that, preventing you from connecting, but your mobile phone is always connected and you have access to whatever you want on the phone. So they're really more powerful computing devices, and their communicating and actuating capabilities are what are very useful and very relevant to the IoT landscape. This is one Mr. Jayavardhana Gubbi. Some science direct article I found it on. Information on tap. This is also very important. One Mr. Mehul Nayak. So he says that everything is being wired up or connected wirelessly. The architecture, the energy efficient sensing, secure networks, quality of service, new protocols, participatory sensing, data mining, GIS based visualization, cloud computing, and international activities. These are basically the enablers for a lot of powerful information that will be there on demand for us. So participatory sensing, I just wanted you to spend half a minute on it. Participatory sensing is where multiple people are you know, using the same application at the same time and sending data so that the entity or the company or the set of computers that is collecting that data can is basically crowdsourcing information to make decisions. You've heard of crowdsourcing? Yes? Can anybody give an example of crowdsourcing?
Crowdsourcing is for if somebody falls ill, you know, they collect money for crowdsourcing.
Crowdfunding. Yeah, crowdfunding, yes. Yes, crowdfunding is similar to crowdsourcing, yes, or that is one application of crowdsourcing, yes. Any other, something we use every day while commuting or while traveling? Sorry? Maps, yes, of course. What in maps?
Locations of people.
Yes, so if like every day, you know, lots of people travel to Hinjewadi for work, thousands of people literally in Pune, right? If even 10% of those people are using GPS enabled, or rather have enabled GPS and using maps, Google Maps, to commute to work, which means hundreds of people are giving this input to Google Maps. Right. So when some 101th person, once he turns on his maps and says, I want to go to my Hinjewadi office and how much time is going to take, then basically the output that he's getting is based on the crowdsourced data which has gone in the past few minutes from people traveling at all different points on that commute. Right. So all the different people who are there on every kilometer of that 10, 20, 30 kilometer commute are telling between every kilometer how much time it's going to take, how much crowded is it, right? And all that data is connected together, and as a result, this new person who just started using his maps application will know whether it's going to take him 20 minutes, 40 minutes, whatever that is, right? So this is a example of participatory sensing and crowdsourcing. Okay, and then all industry and businesses work on commercial implications, right? So which means our profitability, higher productivity. So who other than, you know, Goldman Sachs, which is a financial entity, to say that the global industrial sector is poised to undergo fundamental structural change. They are comparing it, this is a big statement, they are comparing it to the industrial revolution that happened whatever in 18, I don't know, say 16, 17, 18th century. mechanized work, mechanization of work. They are comparing it to such a fundamental, such a big event in our recent history that they are saying that it is akin to industrial revolution. IoT equipment, basically, as we usher in IoT, equipment is becoming more digitized, more connected, establishing networks between machines, humans, and the internet, leading to the creation of new ecosystems, and primarily that enable higher productivity, better energy efficiency, and higher profitability. I am glad they're mentioning better energy efficiency, because we need to be very, very environmentally conscious in everything. All human beings on this planet, I believe, need to be very, very environmentally conscious in all our actions going forward. Otherwise, we are just, you know, destroying the earth and thereby destroying our only small piece of land in this entire big, huge space. Okay, who doesn't agree with this? I'm sure you all agree. Okay, so then this means basically we have sensors and actuators. So initially, the starting point of Internet of Things is basically sensing something, right? The camera or the temperature sensor. You're sensing something, some physical, some scientific entity. You're sensing something, and then you are converting it into data that is useful for consumption, and then you're sending it across. So what are the So sensors are everywhere nowadays. So let's quickly look at some examples of sensors. So there are like light, temperature, humidity sensors, standard stuff. Home security. This is not just a camera, but a home security device. Has anybody seen such a device? They are not very common in India. That's why I'm asking. You have? Okay. Water detection sensors. So these will typically be placed in India. They'll be placed around dams and reservoirs and dry rooms where rooms need to be dry, and if there's a water spillage, then something needs to be done immediately on that. So such places. Motion sensing, somebody already mentioned motion sensing, and then lights that are associated. Accessories. So I had never dreamt that there'll be chips on my ring, and it'll, you know, measure something. It'll measure my hand movement, and it'll send some data. It can also have some security information. So it's like the proximity cards that we use, the access cards that we use for labs or any offices. You can just place your ring there and get in. Smartwatches, of course, everybody knows. How many of you own a smartwatch? An iWatch or you do? Two of you? What watch do you wear?
I have the fitness band.
Okay, fitness band is not exactly a smartwatch, but it's close. How about you? Sorry?
I own
the Chinese watch. That's okay, but it's a watch, right? What OS does it run?
It's
run
Java.
Java? Acha, okay, no problem. Okay, so in sports bands and then virtual reality goggles, all of these are examples of sensors. Are they sensors and actuators also? Many of them are actuators, right? The screen is an actuator. You show something on the screen, you turn it on and show something on the screen. Any action that you take, if a bulb lights up, it's an actuator. If you just measure something, read-only data is sensing, and I mean akin to, I'm giving an analogy from software. So read-only data is like sensing, and if you have read-write or write-only, then that is actuation, right? There's a shirt here. Did you know that there are smart shirts in the US which have sensors, I don't know where all, and they will sense body temperature, they'll sense whether you have, whether you are sweating, and then you will get a command suddenly saying, stop running, you are sweating too much. Or your body temperature is so high, stop, wait, take a break for a few minutes. I don't know what not. So I had not dreamt of. Let's look at a few more sensors. So accelerometer, everybody knows an accelerometer. Okay. Altimeter, everybody knows what an altimeter is. Digital camera, everyone knows, of course. So these are medical sensors. Electrocardiogram, electromyograph, I don't know what it is. Electroencephalogram, electrodermograph, location GPS, of course, mic, oximeter. Everyone knows what a pulse oximeter is? No? pulse oximeter, if I'm not wrong, is a photosensitive method to look into your blood flow and sense the level of oxygen in it. And then there's a range in which it, the healthy range, of course, and if it goes, if the oxygen in your blood goes below that range, then obviously you need medical intervention. So that's what a pulse oximeter is. Bluetooth proximity, of course, pressure, thermometer. These are all medical sensors, and so you this graphic also mentions, you know, where all they are there. So there are headbands that will measure EEG, all those grams. There are sociometric badges, of course, you know, which you put here. The mic is here. Camera clips are here, right? Smart watches, of course, are here. And sensors embedded in clothing, various sensors embedded in clothing. There are like patches. All of you have used Band-Aid. So there are patches that are like Band-Aid, and you connect, you place them on your body, either on your heart for the ECG or on your pulse for the pulse and other, sorry, other measurements, right? So these are examples of sensors. Let's look at your mobile phone. All of these are, you will be surprised at how many sensors are there are on your mobile phone already. Accelerometer, gyroscope, everyone knows what a gyroscope is. Magnetometer, barometer, proximity sensor, light sensor, touch screen, GPS, Wi-Fi, Bluetooth, of course your cell connectivity, near field communication. Everyone knows what NFC is? Yeah, okay, it's like a very, very, that's why it's called near field communication. It's a very short distance communication mechanism. Camera, front and back, of course. So these are all sensors. Can we just list out all the actuators that we think are on our mobile phones? Vibrator, yes. SIM card? I'm not sure about that. Actuator is something that you will control from the system and, you know, use it, perform some action. So I don't think in this particular case there is any control from the system that happens. It's a manual thing and it's a one-time thing. I wouldn't really classify it as an actuator. Camera, yes, you can turn on a camera, right? Do you know of those funny cases in the US, in California, where you have these, nowadays you have these Wi-Fi TVs, right? And then people had Wi-Fi TVs in their bedrooms and without their knowledge, yeah, I'm not joking, you can look up the news, and then without their knowledge, their sleep photographs turned out somewhere on the, due to, of course, some software malfunction, this, that. But photographs or videos of people sleeping turned up on the internet without their knowledge. Okay, I was looking for one more obvious actuator on the phone which I haven't heard from you. Speaker, yes. Screen itself, who said screen? Okay, yes, good. The screen itself is an actuator, right? You get a call, you don't do anything to turn the screen on, it turns itself on. I mean, the system turns it on, right? Okay. Yeah, so you know, sensors are like, there are a plethora of sensors, there are like, I don't know how many thousand companies manufacturing sensors, there are new sensing techniques being developed, and it's a big, big, big topic, and for some interesting new kinds of sensors and sensing techniques, I think Carnegie Mellon University has this particular lab which is called, I forget the full name, it is called Fig Lab, I forget what this FIG expands to. But you can look it up, and they have an entire website where you can spend hours trying to, you know, understand what all different kinds of sensing techniques are there. And this is just one lab. There are so many others doing similar things, and you know, you can just okay. So with that, you know, we are kind of done with the lowest layer also of or the the primary layer of IoT, which is IoT starts with sensing, right? If you have nothing to sense, if you're not sensing anything, if you're not gathering any piece of information which will be used in some larger context somewhere, then you're not going anywhere. So that's a starting point, if I may say so. And we've looked at a lot of, so let's look at the layers now. How are we doing on time? Okay, good. Yeah, so I think this is how I classify. I have not found this definition in any textbook, and different people will look at things differently. If always, as always, you know, there'll be different perspectives. But based on my experience, this is how I classify or categorize the different layers. So essentially, you have the sensor layer. So we looked at a lot of sensors, and nothing is new in this, right? As you will see, they will sensors will talk typically on nowadays, while sensors are also equipped to talk directly to internet and cloud and all that, but that makes them like heavier and more expensive. The cheapest sensors are always those who do sensing and do local communication. So the amount of computing power required to do local communication is always much lower than an entire Ethernet and Wi-Fi stack, right? So Bluetooth is used in like personal devices. Zigbee is something that is used in industrial scenarios, and there are a few other wireless as well as wired. So did you know that these wires, electrical wires that we have, are also used to do power line communication? Were you aware of this? I was not for a while actually, and it was a surprise to me. That you can send data over these copper cables which we have been having for I don't know how many years. So that is called power line communication. So sensors in electrical metering, etc., will basically use that. They don't have wireless. They use power line communications. Okay, then gateways, I think I talked about. So when you have a sensor which talks on Bluetooth, and obviously that the range of Bluetooth is what? Bluetooth 2.0 is 100 meters, and Bluetooth low energy is what, 10 meters. So there is, you cannot send data beyond 10 or 100 meters, whatever that case is. Then you need, whereas you need the data that is being sensed to ultimately go to some cloud server for computation and participation in a larger ecosystem. So how do you do that, right? So one way is to, you know, make the sensor itself communicate to the Ethernet, but as I said, it increases the cost and the size of the sensor. So then the next best thing you could do is have them all the sensors as low cost. Look at the number of sensors also. There are like too many sensors. So if you increase the cost of one sensor, the cost of the entire system goes up by quite a lot. So rather than doing that, you know, keep the cost low of the sensors, since there are hundreds of sensors. Have them all communicate over Bluetooth, but let them communicate to a low cost local computer, which collects all the data from these, and then that computer is slightly, obviously, it is a, while we still calling it a low-cost computer, it is much more powerful than the sensors. It will have all the right infrastructure to connect to an internet system and transfer its data. So let it do it, right? So similar computing devices are called gateways. So you will typically find they are like Linux machines, machines that are running Linux, and they can be like as small as, again, I mean this size or even smaller, duster size, and that's it. So you have if you have like security cameras installed for whatever a large area, then for 100 square meters you will have just one or two gateway devices in that entire area placed at different locations, to which all these sensing cameras can connect, and then you get all your data and just upload to the cloud. Yeah, so these are gateway devices. The protocols or the media that they talk over are, so some of them will talk over Bluetooth. If there are there are times when you need, there are sensors that are available that are capable of talking to the internet. So there will be some, I've depicted one sensor at the bottom here. So it need not, while it can talk to a gateway device, it need not talk to a gateway device. It can directly talk to a cloud service. Typically, it will talk over a particular protocol. I've just depicted an XMPP protocol over here. We will look at XMPP in the protocol section again. Right, so there are gateway devices. Then these will typically talk over various protocols like the common HTTP protocol or the MQTT, which is another IoT specific protocol, to infrastructure on the cloud. And the infrastructure on the cloud can be, you know, various kinds of machines, virtual servers, physical servers, and services. So this this is a notification service over here. That's why it, you know, it resembles a notification on your phone. When you have like three emails or two WhatsApp messages, you see that, you see this kind of an icon with a number. So this is a notification service, and this is an XMPP service. We'll come to the XMPP service part. But essentially, it's a protocol, some service that is being served from the cloud, which talks over a particular protocol so that all devices that are communicating and talk that protocol can connect to this service and transfer data. Okay. This is the third layer, and then the fourth layer is what I call vertical applications. So there is so Facebook is on your phone, right? But there is so much infrastructure that runs Facebook which you don't see, right? So the Facebook app on your phone is the vertical application. That's the only thing that the user sees. And then there are a lot of things happening behind the scenes. So these are all these other things. Yeah, is this okay? Does this make sense? Roughly, yeah? Okay. We'll move on. So I've also, so this is from National Instruments is another big company. It has a lot of, it does a lot of work in IoT space. So they have, I recently attended a seminar and they had a very nice infographic which was useful to understand, you know, what happens in a, so IoT has many applications. So one of them is in the area of industrial applications. So they had this infographic which explains very well, you know, what are the different things that are used in that area. So that's why I thought I should talk a little bit about this. So you will find they have these different things that are used in a factory or in a shop floor that they consider as things. That includes transportation and heavy equipment. For them, sensors and actuators are different things. You know, robots, actuators are robots, and sensors are again light sensing, physical motion sensing, and all those things. Gateways for them loosely translates into edge nodes, what they call as edge nodes, because, and they call these as edge nodes because these are powerful computers or maybe medium power computers, but they are located on shop floor and they are gathering all the information from the sensors, and wherever local, wherever the need to drive those actuators is there, they are fulfilling that need. And then of course there is the, you know, IT infrastructure. They have classified into two parts. One is on-premise, which is again on the shop floor, as we talked about all the computers within a car. So you know, this maps to that. And then this is the cloud infrastructure, as in my previous slide, which is there on the cloud, where all the data processing, storage, takes decision making, learning, data mining, you know, all these things take place on the cloud. And once the result is passed back to the shop floor, then some of these edge nodes are going to drive the actuators to take action. Okay, so I so these guys have drawn a much better diagram than I could here, so I thought I should include it. Okay, with that, let's take a look at protocols. What do you understand by protocol? Sorry? Okay, rules that govern a communication system, very much. So there is something called as a handshake. Yeah, all of, I don't know if how many of you have learned about networking. So there's something called as a handshake. There's something called as a packet. There's something called as a packet structure. There's something called as, you know, mode of communication, and in which the data is packaged into these packages and transferred over, received, interpreted, and then acknowledgement given, and all those things, right? So all the constructs that enable you to do that are captured in a protocol, if I may put it that way. So if you want to communicate to another system, then you have to know what protocol it communicates. You have to have the ability to talk on that protocol, and then you have to construct your data into such a way that the and send it over the protocol so that the communication happens. So what are the different protocols that can be used in IoT context, right? So let's see what all words keywords I have here. 2G is just old mobile technology. LTE is just very new mobile technology. TCP IP everyone knows. SMS, I wouldn't have thought that SMS is an IoT protocol. But in finance, especially financial systems, when you get an OTP on your mobile phone and it is automatically read by an application, and whatever action is taken or verification is deemed to be done is done, that is nothing else but an application of an IoT handshake, right? Time sensitive, location based, user identity and security based communication with a server is what? Is just an example of an IoT implementation in the financial domain, right? So SMS, Wi-Fi, HTTP is like HTTP. I mean, for all web services and all that is the data transferred over web services from the cloud is typically done over HTTP in the IoT context. RFIDs, everyone knows RFIDs. So they are like tags for identification. So they are like sensors. The data that is they are transferring is the RFID number, value, the identity, and the way they do it is wirelessly, right, over RF. So the RFID, good that we are talking about RFID. The RFID reader, you have seen that machine in retail shops, the RFID reader, that is an example of a gateway because it does nearby communication with the RFID tag. And then obviously it will communicate to some server saying this RFID tag is now no longer used. Okay, so I already mentioned Zigbee. I mentioned UDP TCP and UDP, you know. MQTT is a protocol which we will see. It is a IoT specific protocol. AMQP is also IoT specific, which we will see going forward. Then there are some which are old, some which are new. So COAP is a new protocol. It is based on UDP. It is IoT specific. And then I'm not going to read this entire table, but essentially what you should know is everyone has a different kind of transport. Everyone has a different kind of request response mechanism. So some are PubSub, publish subscribe. Some are request response. Yeah, I think these are the only two that are covered in this table. Some work on some technologies like 2G, 3G, 4G. Some are low power and some are not. Some are lossy and some are not. Some require more compute resources and some others not. Security is inbuilt into some of these protocols to a varying level. So that's what it is mentioned in this column. Success stories are basically where these protocols have been applied and used successfully in which domains. So you have like utility and field area networks, medical, military, web servers, smart energy, IoT messaging, network monitoring, consumer, remote management, and I do not know what CERN stands for, sorry. And then the last column, does anybody know what CERN stands for? Maybe, I do not know. Maybe. Okay, fine. If you say so. And then there are various architectures that are that these protocols are built on. So architecture means it includes a topology, addressing of the nodes, communication, hierarchy, and all these things. So basically, some have like tree architecture, star, some have a bus architecture, some have a one-to-one, point-to-point client server architecture. And then there is P2P. Everyone knows P2P? P2P, everyone knows, of course. Okay, some more protocols. So these are some of the protocols we use in our work to implement IoT services and applications. So there is something called as a thread. Does everyone know, has anyone, everyone heard of thread? Yeah, so it's a there's a consortium which controls this, or which has published the standards for this protocol. Then you need to become a member and then access the same. You can get those documents, and then you can write code that will adhere to those protocols. It uses all kinds of data, common data formats. It is used for various platforms, the desktop, web, Android, Arduino, are these small boards, single, yeah, you know that, okay. The media it supports is, you know, it will work over Bluetooth, Wi-Fi, 802.15.4, which is WPAN, NFC, ZigBee. All these media work with this protocol. Example sensors are Philips Hue smart light bulbs, Nest devices, and Freescale MCUs. It's interesting that Freescale MCUs are mentioned, because which means all the sensors that have Freescale MCUs have inbuilt support for Thread. So we had, I remember for one large company, we had done sensor enablement, IoT enablement for a sensor. So they came to us with a Wi-Fi chip. That was to go into microwave ovens, and we put in a small MQTT client on the chip so that it could participate. So once a microwave oven is bought and turned on in the home, then it will connect to the local home Wi-Fi router. Via that, it will connect to the server, and then, as I said, you know, it will download recipes and cook stuff for whatever while it should. Okay, then there is IoTVT, AllJoin, HomeKit. HomeKit is specific to Apple. AllJoin is a consortium, and AllJoin is what is used in a lot of Google devices today. I don't know where IoTVT is used, but that's okay. These are, I just wanted to give you a overview of, you know, and these are not comprehensive. There are far more protocols, some of them which I don't even know. Okay, this is good. We'll move on. So, you know, we've looked at what are the base starting points of an IoT system is, which are basically sensors. We've looked at the various kinds of sensors. We looked at the four layers that that I think are the logical layers of an IoT system. We looked at protocols are very important, because all that any IoT component does is basically exchange data over some mechanism. So protocols are very important, and we looked at just a partial list of all the protocols that are there. Now let's look at basically all of this is fine, you know, all these. So we've kind of looked at all the components, and we've looked at cloud servers, and we've looked at all the components. So, but what do these guys do? What does all this complex system does? You know, what is the core? What are the core pieces of functionality that it needs to cover to be able to be called a IoT system worth its salt? Just let's take a look at that. And then at the, you know, after this, we are going to look at some applications. I hope that will be probably be the most interesting part of this session. Let's see. So essentially, you know, all that. Any sensing and decision making system will do is what? Signal processing. It will collect some signal from its environment. It will convert the signal into data. Yeah. If you digitize it, it becomes data. Then it is stored somewhere. It is logged somewhere. Or log is the right word, not really stored, because it's stored in multiple places for multiple reasons. But essentially, the closest point to where it is sensed, it is logged for future reference. Then it is processed. After it is processed, you get insights into that data on basis of which decisions can be made. This is again sourced from an excellent infographics from National Instruments on Industrial IoT. Yeah, this is clear. This is the key. Essentially, if you know this, if you understand this properly, then you know how an IoT system, or what's the key role of an IoT system and what it's supposed to do. So, There are systems that are very simple, they will follow the same principle. There are systems that are hugely complex, they will still follow the same principle. Okay, so this is a key principle of what an IoT system does. What is the basic data flow? You collect data, you transform it, you collect a signal, you transform it into data, you log it, you process it, and you do, then you after processing what is left will give you decisions. Okay, so sometimes the decisions can be manual and sometimes it can be automated. The system can take decisions, but essentially after processing, whatever insights you get will be turned into decisions. Yes, it's really simple. It's not a big deal. Okay, let's move on. Now, given that this is the core, the last slide had the core functionality of an IoT system, then why are IoT systems so complex? Why do they cost so much money? Why do they take so much time to build? And then what am I doing in IoT for 5 years? I mean, if it was such a simple system, I could probably write a system in a couple of months and be done with it. And why work for so long in IoT? Yeah, and work and continue to work. Why? You'll have this question. So, kya hai bhai ye sab? So then let's look at all the other things that comprise. So when you talk of signal, collecting the signal and converting it into data, we've seen what is required to be done. But obviously, that is not the end of the system. That has to be put into whatever context is being applied into. So when that context is there, then all these things come. Okay. So then you have you have all these integration points. That's why I've called them integration points, because integration elements, because these are not. Need not be the core functionality of an IoT system. These are all add-ons used for context, okay, based on the context. So then you have different kinds of sensors and actuators. So you need to connect to them, you need to collect data, and you need to control them, right? You need to integrate with modules that are cloud ready. So we've seen gateways are there. So you need to be able to talk to gateways, which means you need to write software on the gateways to do their part, right? So that all comes under thing integration for device management. So I'll give you a simple example of device management. Your mobile phones get notifications of app updates, and then you update them. That's, or if you have said update all automatically, then whenever you are on Wi-Fi, it gets auto-updated. That is one simple example of device management. So basically, essentially, whatever firmware or software version is running on your device, if it gets outdated, that is detected and that is updated, and then you get the latest version running, right? That is one aspect of device management, a simple aspect of device management. There, of course, there are a lot of other things like security, data, controlling of data, isolation of data based on user permissions and authorization of use of data and all those things. But that's okay. This is a simple part. Yeah, you have to do configuration management, you have to complete remote updates, you have to make devices campaign ready. And then you have to basically tailor the campaign to whether it's going to a single person or it's going to a group or it's going to masses, right? All IoT devices will typically connect to some cloud service for data. So then, which means all those servers on the cloud, they have to be managed for, what's the CDP, anybody? No? CDPs are your servers from where you get the updates. So its long form is slipping me. Is it content data provider or I'm not sure, I don't remember it. But basically you have to integrate with all those servers. You have to do provisioning and billing across any wireless network. So whenever you use services that have a financial implication, for example, you use your data plan, so you are using your data plan and that is being counted, right, somewhere, so that when your data plan is exhausted, you will be billed for it, and if you overuse it, you will be billed extra for it. So all the integration with those systems needs to be done. That comes under network integration, end-to-end security, who is using the data, the identity of the person to which this data belongs. Is it encrypted on the device? Is it encrypted when it is transferred over the network? Is it encrypted when it is stored on the server? And what are the chances of data being stolen in between any of these points? So all that has to be worried about. Role-based permissions you have to give, you have to encrypt, you have to do auditing and reporting of who is accessing what data. Okay, data exchange I think is self-explanatory. You have like you have comprehensive management portals to manage all the data that is being collected and exchange with all these devices, and then you need scalable data storage for it. There are different applications that you need to integrate with. So typically all applications that you need to integrate with will have APIs, so you need to write your code so that you call those APIs in the appropriate manner and exchange data and basically whatever needs to be done to have that application integration, right? And yes, it includes from very simple functions to like complex functions for big data analytics and so on. Workflows, so what example can I give for workflows? Let's take your bank. Everybody has a bank account and everybody has online banking. Yeah, so there's a workflow in a bank account, right? Even if you do online banking from your mobile phone, there's a workflow that needs to be followed. There's a specific set of steps that needs to be followed. So which means you have to write code on the sensor or on the gateway if you're connecting to such kind of a server that requires a workflow or a particular application that requires a workflow to do things in proper sequence. If you can't take step three before step one. So that is what basically it means. So any kind of application that you're using on your device which requires a specific workflow, you will have to take special steps for integrating the workflow in the right sequence. That's all basically. And then they've given examples, IBM, SAP, Oracle, Microsoft, SQL, Web Services. All these are examples of applications for which you will need to do special things for workflow integration. Okay, so this is what all of this is what puts the complexity into a large IoT system. And if you may design a very simple IoT system for your own home where you sense the temperature and put on the AC, that can be a very simple system. But when it comes to other larger complex systems, if suppose that same home automation thing has to be done for an entire society of 100 flats, then you won't do it this way, na? You won't have 100 instances of that IoT system installed in each flat so that everything takes care, every flat is taken care of independently. That's not what you will do, right? You will have a building management system in place which is a much larger, much complex system based on the same principle, doing the same thing. But since the context is large, you will do something different. It will be more complex, it will be centrally managed, yeah? And it will be all connected, it will not be independent. There won't be 100 independent systems, it will be one single connected system. So, as your context grows larger, the complexity in the system increases, and what you will do to while the data being sensed is the same and the decisions being taken are the same, between these two things, what data transfers across which modules of the IoT system and how the decision is arrived at changes. Yeah, make sense? Okay, let's look at another important thing of any business or enterprise is that managements will want to see only the top level data that enables them to make decisions, right? So then any kind of an IoT system will always have management reporting, and it will typically be as jazzy as something that you are seeing here. So this is from a mobile device management system. So you see that in a particular implementation or an instance, what the manager or the controller is seeing is that like there are 290 devices for some of them. 240 of them are policy compliant, some are not. And then there are some alerts for some devices. Right? All these vary, basically numbers and statuses which will allow him to take some actions. FOTA is firmware over the air. So similar to our mobile apps, applications getting updated, all embedded systems, the firmware running on embedded systems or the software running on embedded systems is called firmware. So whenever a firmware version gets out of date and it needs to be replaced, then it is already connected wirelessly or in a wired, it's called over the air, which implies wirelessly, but it need not be wirelessly. It is connected to the IoT system servers in some manner, so that same mechanism is used to update the firmware on those systems. Okay, so that is what is called FOTA, and this management report is giving you know how many devices have been upgraded and how many are in process, how many are postponed. This yellow band corresponds to postponed. Similar, you know, management dashboards telling, you know, giving the diagnostic summary. So if a machine or if a mobile has a problem, then what is the problem? What is the device? Which test gave that problem? What is the progress? All these things. Okay. Now let's come to the last part. So now you've seen the basics, you know, what comprises, what are the components, what are the layers, and what are the key functionalities of an IoT system. Now let's see where all it is applied. Now I think, I hope that as we talk about applications, and I want you to be very interactive in this session, because I do not see all applications. You may already be observing some applications around you, and I want you to talk about them or point out similarities to what I'm showing you. And that is where I think you will realize how it all comes together and where the complexity is and why it is there. So let's talk about a few applications. I have a bunch of them. I don't think we'll be able to talk about all of them, but that's okay. That's not important. We will talk about maybe one or two in deep details, and then the all others will be similar. The devices will be different, the protocols will be different, the systems serving up those will be different, the decisions taken will be different, but the concept will be the same. So let's take a look at maybe one or two, one in healthcare maybe, and one in home automation maybe, and then all others will be similar. So application categories are like some of the categories I'm mentioning: building automation, transport systems, shop floor monitoring, smart city, health management, and environmental monitoring. So in environmental monitoring, you are seeing a map here, and so this can be something like a geographical area, or if you are monitoring a national park, for example, how much of it is wooded, green, how much of it is water body, and over the years, if you are mapping across seasons, you know, how much of the land gets barren and without green cover during summer, and how much of it gets back into green cover after rains and all that. So these are all typically GIS and map based applications. These are enterprise applications. You will not see this on your phone. We will not use them in as individual consumers, but this will be done for like specific departments for specific enterprises. So that is what is environmental monitoring. Weather will be included in that. So weather forecasting will be included in that, and all geospatial applications will be included in that. Okay. Shop floor monitoring is like on the manufacturing floor in a factory. Transport system is like pieces of you know, your transport, buses, trucks, blah blah blah. And fleet management, for example, I have an example of fleet management that we can talk about. Smart cities, like city lights, turning off the lights when it is sundown, sorry, turning on the lights when it's sundown, and turning them off at daybreak. So there'll be sensors which are photosensitive sensors, which will you know, tell the system that it is daybreak now and you should turn off the lights, and vice versa. Okay, so since I know this car is a very it's a concept which is very near and dear to all of us, and smart cars with cameras and self-driving cars even more so nowadays, and even my company Harman, we work a lot into self-driving cars, autonomous cars, or car technology. We have car infotainment, we have car audio, right? I think Harman is probably one of the world leaders in infotainment and audio technology. So, but in order that I do not spill any official secrets with you guys, I have excluded those examples. Okay. even inadvertently. What happens is, you know, you get passionate about something you're working on, and then you talk, and then you realize that, oh, I shouldn't have told this. So I didn't want to get into that. So the examples in this session are rather bland, but I think you'll just have to live with it. Okay, let's not, so basically this talks about, you know, where, how the different parts of an IoT system, which is running a shop floor where you're making a car, come together, the factory basically, right? And then there's a shop floor, then there's an embedded cloud, there's product usage data, somebody's doing designs, mechanical designs first, and then some. So you can see all the different functions that interact with this. There's sales and marketing, right? There's work environment, adaptive logistics, aftermarket services, IoT service operation, IoT service implementation, IoT enabled manufacturing, and end-to-end digital engineering. So many various departments coming together to run a shop floor in an automated manner, and different responsibilities of different departments, different pieces of source code or functionality implemented by different departments and owned by different departments. So it becomes a very, very complex system to write, implement, and operate. Yeah. Okay, let's look at some health examples. So these are some of the projects that we have done, and some of the I have personally worked on in health. So on the top left, you see a fall detection sensor. So it's like a it's like an Ethernet Wi-Fi device, Wi-Fi adapter kind of a sized device which sits in your home. There's a phone line plugged into it. You see those two sensors there, right? You see two sensors over there. So they are sensors which you can attach to your belt, clip to your belt like this. So this system is meant for elderly people, and when they use this system with the, they move around. So some, you are living in a big house and in a garden and this and that, and just you know, man and wife, two elderly people living in that home, or it may be applied to a old age home where there are multiple people. But essentially, you the person clips this belt, clips this device to his belt, and moves around, does his normal job. It is a non-intrusive device. It doesn't even remember it's there. But if he falls, the moment he starts falling, the fall detection algorithms which are running on this device and constantly measuring the movement of that person using axle and gyro will kick into place. They will place an emergency call to the base station here wirelessly. The base station is installed in the house or wherever it is, right? And the person is moving about. So if he's in the garden, if he, the moment he starts to fall, the algorithm will kick in. It will give a wireless connection, get a wireless connection, and communicate this same to the base device. Since the base device is equipped with a phone line, it will use the phone line to, you know, call emergency services, and somebody will call. Right, the user can also press a button on this device and talk, saying if he's in a position to talk after he has fallen. By the time he has fallen, somebody knows and help is on its way. So somebody will call this person, if he can talk, he's in a position to talk, he can talk, saying, no, I'm okay, I'm just fallen down, or I need help, or it's paining, or whatever has happened. You know, he can talk if he can, he's in a position to talk. Or otherwise, within a few minutes, you will have an ambulance outside the house, people running in, rushing in, and help at hand, basically. I mentioned a patch, I think, earlier. So we work with our customers to on medical patches, which are FDA certified. You attach the patch to some part of your body here, here, wherever, whatever the measurement needs to be done. And all these medical parameters are measured. They either go to your watch, a smartwatch, and via the smartwatch to the cloud, or they go to your mobile phone, and via the mobile phone to your cloud. There needs to be, so for medical and health devices, there are special considerations. For example, HIPAA compliance, identity and security is very important. The data cannot be stolen. Suppose there is some legal case, say there's some accident or there is some death, and in the previous week there was some measurement of blood sugar measurement that was done and the record was there. And if 5 years down the line, you know, there is some case, court case going on due to the death, and if the judge says ki, in the previous week when this health measurement was done, I want to see that data, then the system that collects and stores this data is supposed to make that available for the court case even after 5 years of that event occurring. So this is what adds complexity to the entire system. right? I may be able to write a simple program to do the measurement and be done with it, but that is not useful. In the real world, there are lawyers and you need to be able to satisfy all different kinds of people, right? Okay. ECG patch, again, it's a similar this thing. Stress management, so you'll either have a band or you'll have a band around the neck or around over here, or there'll be some kind of heart rate management. Now, there is one simple or common sense correlation that I'll tell you. Your heart rate is always varying, right? It's supposed to be 72 or around that, but if you measure it, 1 minute it will be like, if you're very relaxed, it will go down to maybe 65, 60 at times. If you're meditating some yogic posture, it may go down to 60. And if you're like in the field playing football, it will go down to 120, I don't know, 150 at times, yeah? And then you have these tests also to tell you the health of the heart, whereby they will try to test it and take it to maximum and see how much your heart sustains, right? How much do you get tired? So those tests are also there. So essentially, if your heart rate variation from minute to minute, if it is low, then you are under stress. Because if for example, if you're writing an exam, you're concentrating so much, you are looking at a supervisor, if you want to do some hanky-panky, then you are very careful that nobody notices. So I'm just giving an example. So all these things add to the stress, and you are really focused, and your body physiology also understands that it should not, you know, jump about. So your heart rate will be in a low variability range. So if it will say maybe it will be slightly higher than normal. So I'm just taking examples, and like these are just representative examples. So if the normal heart rate is 72, at that point your heart rate maybe will be increased a little to 78 or 80, but it will vary between only maybe 78 and 82. It will not vary more than that. Okay, for that period of time under which you are stressed. In which you are under stress, okay? Whereas if you're going out and playing playing football on the ground, then I don't know if anybody who's under stress while playing football, okay? So if you measure the heart rate every minute for the 20 minutes or 30 minute game that person is on the football ground, then you will find a lot of variation. You'll find a lot of highs, 120, 130, 158 times when he's running very fast, hitting the goal or whatever. But at other times it'll get low. It'll get down to 72, you know, between breaks he may, if he's like using some meditation techniques to relax himself, it may even get down to below 72, okay? So point is, if you look at the range of variability, it'll be around 70, 72 to 120. So that variability band is much more, right? And medical science and research says that if the variability band is high, you are not under stress. You are in a relaxed atmosphere, your body physiology is knows that it can take distractions. When you're in an exam, if some bell rings, if someone else gets up and asks for a supplement, your body physiology will not allow you to get distracted. It'll tell you to no focus on your paper. Is that right? Whereas when you're on a football field, some crowds are cheering, some flag is waving somewhere, something's happening, you look at it, you don't have a problem. It's a break, you look at it. While playing, of course, you're playing, but otherwise in a break or when you're waiting for a penalty shootout, you're not going to look anywhere here, there, right? So point is, your body physiology is also aware that you can take distractions. And because you take distractions and you get distracted, your heart rate is affected. The heart rate changes much more and the variation is much more, okay? So basically these kind of things. So when you're doing a health application in IoT, this is the research that you will apply. Okay, another example, one example I'll give in health is sports training. So this is another application I worked on for a California startup client. And this is basically an application that allows you to play golf. So we built a sensor which has an axle and a gyro on it. And if this is a golf club, you play golf with it, then just below the handle, you place the sensor, you clip the sensor on. It's a very lightweight sensor, less than 10 grams. So the player won't feel as anything is there, basically. It won't hamper his game in any way. And then when the player plays golf, then all the, with the axle and gyro and all the data that is obtained and then computed together on the phone, not on the sensor but on the phone, the user will basically be told ki how much your hand is going far behind, does it need to go far much more further, does he need to stretch much more further. When he hits the golf ball, the ball is like this and the club is like this. So the club can hit in one of the three directions, right? This way, or this way. Plus, it can hit in one of the three angles, right? It can hit straight, it can hit from bottom up, or it can hit from top down, right? So all these different statistics are measured, calculated, computed, and told to the user. Ki, you do this because your angle is wrong. You do this because you take your hand, stretch your hand much farther because the force with which you are hitting the ball is much less than it should be. And then, once you know all this, you can actually compute the trajectory of the ball without, so the sensor doesn't go on the ball, right? The ball, the golf ball will be hit and it will go somewhere. But once you've measured all of these things, you can predict where the ball is going. So you can show the, so this application showed the trajectory the ball was following once the golfer hit the ball on the phone. All this was also stored on the cloud because then he will want to see ki month over month as he is getting tips from this app and playing and changing his game, how is he improving. So the force at which he is hitting, has that improved in the past 1 month, right? So for that you need historical data and all that is kept on the cloud and there are web applications and UIs to show him all of that. So that is one example. So you will see that any kind of sensing technique, computation and decision making is applicable, universally applicable, applicable to a lot of things that we do. Okay, this is one. Home, someone was, we were talking about smart home. So here is this smart home system that we built for one of our large clients. There are Philips Hue bulbs over there. Philips Hue also has a bridge or a Wi-Fi gateway which talks to these bulbs. And then we had an home gateway which spoke over MQTT, which spoke to the Philips Hue bulb over Bluetooth and spoke to the cloud server over MQTT. And so we have just shown bulbs over here, but of course it includes all sorts of devices that are there in the home. So the typical use case for this or the desired use case for this that we implemented was I leave my office. My phone is there, it knows from GPS location if it's turned on that I'm moving out of my office, right? That's called geofencing. The moment I leave from my office, my home AC needs to be started on because during the day when I'm in office, that AC is turned off, right? So the moment, and it takes maybe 20 minutes for me to reach home and it takes 20 minutes for my house to come to the temperature that is there normally when I need it. Right now what happens if I go home and turn on the AC, it will take 20 minutes before we get comfortable. So the idea here is as soon as I start from office, if since it takes 20 minutes for both things to happen, the AC in my home will be turned on remotely via the internet, okay, via this mechanism basically. So by the time I reach home and I open the door, it will be at the same temperature. Similarly, my house is going to have some security system installed. It is armed, which means when I leave for office, it is armed, right? Armed is a term used to say that it is basically put in motion to see that no intruder is there. If somebody is there, then raise the alarm. When I reach home, it will need to be disarmed. So when I reach home, my mobile phone will, via again the internet from GPS, it will know that I have reached home. I'm in my garage parking my car. So my garage door will open. I don't need to do anything for it. When I start to get into the house, my security system will be disarmed, so that I can just push the door and get in. No alarm will be raised, right? And the last thing is, I like some music. I like playing different musics at different times, or I like playing different music in my car. I like playing different music in my home, or I like to listen to music such that what I'm listening right now continues wherever I go. So if I'm listening to a particular, suppose I'm of this last type, and if I'm listening to one particular Indian classical record by Kishore Amonkar in my car, and so I get out of the car, I get into the home, my security is the system is disarmed, I get into the house and the speaker in my living room starts blurting out the same music that I was listening in my car from the point where it stopped in the car to, you know, forward. So this is the kind of, so all that we are doing, I mean if you look at all the industrial the aim of all industrial activity is to ultimately make our life more convenient, right? So this is where basically it falls. Okay, then this was smart city. I'll not dwell much on this remote metering, these electricity meters in our house. You measure how much electricity you are consuming. You get billed automatically. Smart grid is about, again, it's an energy, but where you produce energy and supply it to the grid. Fleet management. So this is one sample use case in which we had worked where there are ice creams, like we get when it's like we want to have ice cream, we go to our nearby shop and have ice cream, but we don't think ki wo ice cream kahan se aaya, kab aaya, did it come and when in transit, when from the production facility to that shop, all the time it transited in different vehicles, was it at the same temperature or did it, you know, grow warm at one point and then was put into was made cold again? Yeah, so the fleet management applications which will do this activity are basically also an example of an IoT system. So the trucks are equipped with cold storage, fridges, and there are temperature sensors over there. So right from the moment the truck leaves the factory to various places it goes and puts in, distributes its wares, the temperature is continuously monitored and the information is sent back to headquarters wherever it is being monitored, so that so ice cream is probably not a good example for this, but any fresh food, fresh fish, right? So if they get out of cold storage for a while and then you put them back in, they turn bad. So the company who's selling these wares can make a decision ki for these set of trucks in my fleet, since the temperature was not maintained throughout, then this produce is bad, it should not go to consumers. This decision can be made if the entire system is being monitored. So basically that is what is achieved here. Yeah, I think in we are almost at the end. Can I take a few more minutes to just discuss one last use case in fleet management itself? So where does this, can you tell me where does fleet management, or how can fleet management apply to our daily commutes? Let's discuss that together, collectively. Let's discuss a use case together. How will it apply to us? Our daily lives. I am going to office every day. How can a fleet management system implemented using IoT benefit me? What can needs to be done?
Carpooling.
Yes, there are a lot of things that can be done. Carpooling is one thing. What else? Yes, right. And this is a lot of things that can be done. I want to see how many of it we can bring out together. Okay, yes, good use case. Although I don't plan for accidents every day, but if it happens, then yes, I need immediate assistance. Yes, good use case. Yeah, so I think it's similar to the case that someone mentioned, like the best route to office and the time it's going to take includes congestion detection and rerouting and this and that. Yes. Excellent. I was looking for this answer. So you know what we take for granted, especially if we are living in Pune for a while, is that since the government bus facility is so bad, we are so used to being on our own in terms of transport. But if you look at the importance that we need to give to our environment, we really shouldn't be traveling on our own vehicles, because if you ride a bike or a car individually, you waste much more fuel and the overall impact on environment is much worse than if 10 or 20 or 50 of you hop on a bus. Okay, so now as a consumer, so let's focus on the bus part. So all these car, bike, accident and route and all these are fine, which I think we do anyway, most of them, except maybe the accident part. But let's focus on the bus. How can an IoT system, or what an IoT system needs to do so that I as a bus rider will be benefited? What all do I need?
Sharing the bus, we can select.
Yeah, but this is a special case of, you know, why do we need a special case? You know, PMT, Pune Municipal Transport already has routes worked out, and they already have buses plying. So we don't really need to identify or call a special bus or and say ki these 50 people need to travel. That is not required. Buses are already there, they are plying. So, I mean, while this is useful, I don't think this is really the most important part. This is useful, no question about it. Yes, sir. Yes. So, based on where I am, location, where I am, my house is in a particular area, there will be n number of bus stops, maybe, hopefully, you know, two or three different on different roads nearby within a kilometer of walking from my home, hopefully. Then I need to know, suppose there are two bus stops for different places near my home, then I need to know ki on which bus stop, which buses are coming next in the next 15 minutes. Right, in the next 15 minutes, because I'll take 10 minutes to walk that kilometer or half a kilometer to the bus stop if I start right now. So when I'm walking out of my door, if I can pull out an app which tells me ki acha this bus stop in and that place, there are like two buses where you want to go in the next 15 minutes or after the next 15 minutes. On this bus stop, there's just one bus, but it's after 30 minutes. Whatever that input is. Then I decide ki I want to go here or here. Once I go there, then what do I need? Where the bus is, right? If I decide ki there are two buses coming and I decide either of is okay or one particular bus I need, then what I need is, when exactly is that bus coming there? How many people is it? Is it crowded? Will I be able to get in or not? Or do I need to look for another bus? If both the buses on this are going to be crowded, I am not going to be able to get in, and I better walk to the other bus stop, wait 30 minutes and get into a bus. At least I'll get into a bus, right? So then, who will give this input of whether the bus is crowded? Excellent. So if all bus commuters use this app, right, then look at when what happens. Suppose I find a bus and I climb onto the bus, then what input does the system need from me? My GPS location, which bus number is that, because that nobody will be able to identify just from location. I need to tell you this is bus number 92 going from whatever. I'm climbed into this bus at this location. So all the people who are climbing into the bus, if they give this input, then the system knows ki that bus, which is, because bus timetable which is printed on paper, it's never adhered to or may not be adhered to for various reasons. Let's not blame anybody. There are real reasons why it cannot be adhered to. Traffic, this, that, blah, blah, blah. Okay. But if like 50 people onto a bus, and in our case even more, maybe 70 people, 25 of them standing. If all of them have given this input, then the system knows ki there is a bus, it is crowded or not crowded, it is at this location, and then it is on this route, and then where it will reach in what time, what is the projected time, based on the maps and the traffic and all those things, right? Now, if such a system was operational, do you think most of us will take the bus? Yes, why won't we take, why do you buy a car, you maintain it, you spend so much on it, and then, I mean, you do all that, but you don't use it for daily commute then. If daily commute becomes so convenient and cheap, then there is no need for me to go use my car to go to office, right? I'd rather ride a bus and be tension free. Then I don't need that accident facility, monitoring facility, right? Okay. So yeah. So basically, that's I just wanted to end on this particular use case because it is like so relevant to all of us. That's where I stop. If you have any more questions that you'd like to answer. I can answer. I also tweet on Twitter, Atul Nene. You can send me request on LinkedIn. I think I already got one. I think I've got one more. I don't remember the name. If you want, my email address, I'll tell you, it is atul.nene@harman.com or then atul.nene@gmail.com. If you send me email, I'll try my best to respond. In some way or the other, at some time or the other. And I would like to thank Professor Jayaraman. He met me at this recent symposium where we felicitated Dr. Sahasrabuddhe, Hari Sahasrabuddhe. And I'm very glad. I thank you so much, Professor, for inviting me here. I've enjoyed talking to you guys. Thank you. Thank you. Thank you.